Hi everyone, my name is Johnny Dark, and welcome back to Lincoln Part 3. In 1858, Abraham Lincoln was running for the Senate seat held by Stephen A. Douglas. He would confide to journalist Henry Villard that he doubted his ability to be a senator, although he would add, "My wife is quite confident that someday I shall be the president." "Just imagine," he exclaimed, wrapping his long arms around his knees, giving off a roar of laughter, "of such a sucker as me as president." In December of 1859, Jesse W. Fell, a Bloomington politician, would ask Abraham Lincoln to write an autobiographical account of his life that had been requested by Joseph J. Lewis of the Chester County Times in Pennsylvania. The newspaper, it seemed, wanted to do an article on him. Abraham Lincoln said this would be done. He sent off the story with a postscript. "Herewith is a little sketch. There is not much of it for the reason, I suppose, that there is not much of me. If anything be made of it, I wish it to be modest and not go beyond the material. If any personal description of me is thought desirable, it may be said that I am in height 6 feet 4 inches, nearly, lean in flesh, weighing on an average of 180, dark complexion, with coarse black hair and gray eyes. No other marks or brands recollected." At the conclusion of Part 2, Abraham Lincoln, on April 15th of 1837, packed up his saddlebags, got on a borrowed horse, and rode out of New Salem forever, leaving behind the shops and the taverns he had worked and lived in, the Clary's Grove boys with Jack and Hannah Armstrong, and his friend James Rutledge. He would slowly ride into Springfield, Illinois, where he would reside for the next quarter of a century. In 1838, in Springfield, in the legislature, and on the road to becoming a successful lawyer, Abraham Lincoln would deliver up a speech for the Young Men Linemen's Association he would entitle "The Perpetuation of Our Political Institutions." In it, he would boast, "America need have no fear of foreign invasion. At what point shall we expect the approach of danger? By what means shall we fortify against it? Shall we expect some transatlantic military giant to step the earth and crush us at a blow? Never. All the armies of Europe, Asia, and Africa combined, with all the treasure in the world in their military chest, could not by force take a drink from the Ohio River or make a track on the Blue Ridge in a trial of 1,000 years. At what point, then, can the approach of danger be expected? I say that if it ever reach us, it must spring up from among us. It cannot come from abroad. If destruction be our lot, we ourselves must be its author and finisher. As a nation of free men, we shall live through all time or die by suicide." In 1840, in Springfield, in the legislature, but not at the Capitol building, still under construction, but across the way at the Methodist Church, Abraham Lincoln would be involved in an incident that became known as that jumping scrape. It seems that the Democrats wanted to destroy the Illinois State Bank by forcing it to pay out specie, notes for coins. This would embarrass and ultimately ruin the bank. But in order for the Democrats to do this, they would have to have a quorum. The Whigs, including Abraham Lincoln, all in favor of the Illinois State Bank, needed to exit themselves immediately from the building so that that quorum could not be formed. They all ran for the front door, finding it locked and guarded by the sergeant of arms. And then they ran for the windows, and they opened them, and they jumped from the second story. Of course, this was done for naught, for the roll call had already been taken, but they made their point, and it proved to be one of the more comical escapades of Abraham Lincoln's most illustrious life. Although later, he would be somewhat embarrassed by it. In December of 1839, at the Grand Cotillion, honoring the completion of the Capitol building in Springfield, Illinois, Abraham Lincoln would meet and fall in love with Mary Todd, of the aristocratic Todd families that had settled Lexington, Kentucky. So aristocratic, Abraham Lincoln would say, that the Todds needed to have two D's in their name, where God only needed one. Mary Todd was a vivacious brunette, just 5'4" tall, fair skin, blue eyes, and a bent towards plumpness. And she was sought after by every eligible bachelor in Springfield, including Stephen A. Douglas, although later she would say that all her suitors were hard bargains. She was so charming, so flirtatious, her brother-in-law, Ninian Edwards, would say she could make a bishop forget his prayers. Mary Todd had come to Springfield, Illinois, to live with her sister and her husband, Mr. and Mrs. Ninian Edwards, on the outskirts of town, in their very large home. She had done this primarily to get away from her stepmother, Mrs. Elizabeth Humphreys Todd, who she despised. Of the parties and the balls thrown by the Edwardses, her disapproving sister would say that Mr. Lincoln would sit next to Mary Todd, listening to her, barely saying a word, gazing on her as if drawn by some superior power. Yes, he was smitten. And after just a few weeks, they would become an item. In 1840, Abraham Lincoln would run once again for the legislature, as well as hit the campaign trail for William Henry Harrison and his running mate, John Tyler, to be the president and vice president of the United States. The slogan throughout the country was Tippecanoe and Tyler too, and they were all cheered on mightily by Mary Todd, and they would all be successful. William Henry Harrison would be elected the 9th president of the United States, only to succumb in that office after just 1 month, making way for his vice president, John Tyler, to become the 10th president of the United States. Abraham Lincoln would also be elected to the legislature once again. Just a few weeks after the election, Abraham Lincoln would propose his hand in marriage to Mary Todd, and she would accept. Things were now going along swimmingly. He was part of high society in Springfield. He was in the legislature, and he was on the road to becoming a successful lawyer, thanks in part to his law partner, John Todd Stewart, who left the lawyering to him as he went off to Washington, D.C. to seek a seat in the House of Representatives. But very soon, the hypochondria reared its ugly head, and once again, Abraham Lincoln was filled with melancholy and despair, depressed over the fact that he knew he could not even keep his own resolves when he made them, and especially when it came to marriage. He would write a friend that the thought of marriage was indescribably horrible and alarming to him. He would then go see his best friend, Joshua Fry Speed, and he told him that he intended on calling off his engagement to Mary Todd by writing her a letter, telling her he did not wish to be married to her because he simply did not love her. Speed would tell him that if he had to do this thing, he had to do it in person, face to face. Any sort of correspondence would only serve as a monument against him if he ever had a change of heart. And so it was on January 20th of 1841 that Abraham Lincoln would write his friend, his law partner, and Black Hawk War veteran John Todd Stewart, now finishing up his term in Washington, D.C. as a congressman, urging him to obtain the Springfield postmastership for Dr. Anson Henry. He would go on to explain. "I have, within the last few days, been making a most discreditable exhibition of myself in the way of hypochondriacism. Thereby, I get the impression that Dr. Henry is necessary for my existence. Without this position, he leaves Springfield." 3 days later, he would write another letter to John Todd Stewart, this time lamenting the fatal first, January 1st, 1841. The day that Abraham Lincoln, on the advice of his best friend, Joshua Fry Speed, would call off his engagement to Mary Todd in person, face to face, telling her he did not wish to be married to her because he simply did not love her. Knowing how badly he had wounded her, he would say in the letter, "I am now the most miserable man living. If what I feel were equally distributed to the whole human family, there would not be one cheerful face on the earth. Whether I shall ever be better, I cannot tell. I awfully forebode that I shall not. But to remain as I am is impossible. I must die or be better, it appears to me." Once again, Abraham Lincoln's close friends felt that he might take his own life. Joshua Speed would go so far as to remove the razors and knives from his room and hide anything in which he might harm himself with. At this same time of the year, Joshua Speed had decided to give up his interest in a general store and go back to Kentucky to be with his mother and his fiancée, Fanny Hennings, on his very large plantation at Farmington. It seems that Speed's father had died, and he felt the need to be close to his mother at this crucial time. In August of that year, Abraham Lincoln would take an extended vacation where he too would go off to Kentucky to spend time with the Speeds and Miss Hennings in order to make his recovery. And while he was back there, Joshua Fry Speed's mother would present Abraham Lincoln the gift of an Oxford Bible, urging him to read it, that it would bring him solace and peace of mind, and that it was, in fact, the very best cure for the blues. Abraham Lincoln assured her that he would, and indeed he did. Before returning to Springfield, he and Speed would take a trip on a steamship on the Ohio River from St. Louis to Louisville, where on September 27th of 1841, Abraham Lincoln would write a letter to Speed's sister Mary, telling her of their adventure. "There were on board a cargo of 12 Negro slaves, chained and shackled 6 and 6 together, being forever separated from the scenes of their childhood, their friends, their fathers and mothers, sisters and brothers, husbands and wives and children. And yet, nevertheless, they seemed to be the most cheerful and apparently happy creatures on board. Years later, at about midlife in 1855, Abraham Lincoln would remember that incident quite differently in a letter to Speed himself. In 1841, you may remember, as I well do, we had a tedious low water trip on a steamship from St. Louis to Louisville. There were on board a cargo of 10 or 12 Negro slaves chained with irons. That sight has been a continual torment to me, which has and continually exercises the power of making me miserable." When finally returning to Springfield, somewhat recovered, Abraham Lincoln went right back to work at being a lawyer. And then very soon he was receiving letters from his best friend Joshua Fry Speed that now he was having misgivings about marrying his fiancée, Miss Fanny Hennings. He would write, he felt he just did not love her. Abraham Lincoln would write, "Nonsense! Well, of course you love her. You did not ask Miss Hennings to marry you because of her wealth, because she hasn't any, or because she's moral, sensible, amiable, and of good character. You ask her to marry you simply because you have fallen head over heels in love with her. Why else would you have been so concerned when she took ill? I tell you, Speed, our forebodings, for which you and I are rather peculiar, is all the worst sort of nonsense. I predict that in 2 or 3 months you shall be the happiest of men." Convinced on Abraham Lincoln's arguments, Joshua Fry Speed would marry his Fanny Hennings, and he would write back he was indeed happy. Abraham Lincoln would write back as well, "The short space it took me to read your last letter gave me more pleasure than the total sum I have received since that fatal first of January 41. Since then, it seems to me that I should have been entirely happy, but for the never absent idea that there is one still unhappy whom I've contributed to make so. That still kills my soul. I cannot but reproach myself for even wishing to be happy. Well, she is otherwise. They were, of course, talking about Mary Todd, who at this very time was obsessing over the notion that perhaps her Mr. Lincoln was really in love with her brother-in-law's pious and beautiful cousin, the 18-year-old Matilda Edwards, a formidable competitor. There was even talk that Joshua Fry Speed was in love with her. At this same time of the year, Mary Todd was being squired around by Edwin B. Webb, a widower with two small children of his own. She would try to discourage his attention at every turn, but to no avail. She really had no choice, for she was still deep in the throes of a terrible broken heart, as she would explain in a letter to her dear friend Mercy Ann Leving of Baltimore about Mr. Lincoln. "He deems me unworthy of notice, as I have not met him in the gay world for months. With the usual comfort of misery, I imagine others are seldom as gladdened by his presence as my humble self. Yet I would that the case were different, that he would once again resume his station in society, that Richard should be himself again. Much, much happiness would this afford me." Just a few years after the Panic of 1837, the Illinois State Bank notes fell to 44 cents on the dollar. Local tax auditor and Democrat Colonel James Shields informed his collectors that anyone paying taxes with these notes that they would only be worth that 44 cents, causing a huge uproar in the state. Abraham Lincoln, the master politician, saw this as a way to get at the Democrats, and he would compose the Lost Township Letters under the pseudonym of Rebecca, a backwoods woman who was crafty and smart, and who would accuse Colonel Shields of being everything from an egotist to a womanizer to an out-and-out dunce, and definitely a Whig, not a Democrat. When Mary Todd and her best girlfriend, Julia Jane, read the first of these letters, they enjoyed it so very much that they would actually write the second of the Lost Township Letters. Colonel James Shields was not a man to be trifled with. He was a hot-tempered Irishman from the county of Erie and with no sense of humor. And he demanded to know from the editor of the Sangamo Journal, Simeon Francis, who had written these letters. When the editor informed Mr. Lincoln, he told him, "Well, you tell him it was me, and just me, and me alone." Colonel Shields, on September 17th of 1842, sent a letter directly to Abraham Lincoln demanding a retraction and an apology immediately. And if this was not done to his satisfaction, then he may proceed to choose the weapon of his choice. Abraham Lincoln did not want to duel this man, but he felt the letter contained so much menace, of forethought, assumption, of facts. He refused to answer it. And very soon, the highly volatile seconds had taken over Dr. Elias Merriman and William Butler for Abraham Lincoln and a Mr. Whiteside for Colonel Shields. Dueling was illegal in Illinois, so they would have to cross the river at Alton in the Missouri. And just as the cavalry broadswords were being passed out, that being the weapon of Mr. Lincoln's choice, knowing that Colonel Shields was not just a hot-tempered Irishman, he was a crack shot. Suddenly, cooler heads prevailed, and with the intervention of Mary Todd's relative, John J. Hardin, and a Dr. English, the whole thing was called off. Colonel Shields would even take the time to apologize to Mr. Lincoln for his menace of forethought and his assumptions of fact, so that Mr. Lincoln could also apologize to him, explaining that he meant nothing personally to his character. This was just a political tool used to get at the Democrats. Although the incident was called off, it proved to be one of the most embarrassing of Abraham Lincoln's life. And for the rest of his life, he and Mary Todd would never, ever discuss it. Once, when he was serving his first term as the President of the United States, an impertinent young officer would ask him, "Is it true, Mr. President, that you were involved in a duel?" Well, Abraham Lincoln would look up sternly and say, "I do not deny it, but if you desire my friendship, you shall never mention it again." This was not the first time that Abraham Lincoln had tried his cases in the newspapers as opposed to the courts where they actually belonged. It happened very early on in New Salem with the Chronicles of Reuben, where he lampooned the Grimsby brothers' dual wedding. And then it happened when he first got to Springfield, when he learned that his dear friend and Whig, Dr. Anson Henry, was running for the lucrative position of probate judge against a powerful Democrat by the name of General James Adams. Suddenly it came to Mr. Lincoln's attention by the way of a widow by the name of Mrs. Mary Anderson that she and her son Richard had been swindled out of 10 acres of land by this General Adams, and she had the documents to prove it. Well, Abraham Lincoln looked over these documents and he found them to be valid, but just to be sure, he called in for a second counsel, that of Stephen T. Logan. Both lawyers agreed that yes, that General James Adams had indeed swindled the 10 acres of land off Mrs. Mary Anderson and her son Richard. So they would compose, on the spot, anonymously, six letters known as the Sampson Ghost Letters, where they would accuse General Adams of being a Tory and for the Hartford Convention and a swindler. General James Adams was not a man to be trifled with either. He was a powerful Democrat, and he would write his own letters and have them reprinted in a Democratic journal known, ironically, as the Republican, stating that I know all this fuss ain't nothing more than a knot of Whigs who are trying to ruin me simply because I am a Democrat. And I know this Lincoln feller is behind it, and if you ask me, Abraham Lincoln ain't nothing but a deist. Well, people paid little attention to either of these letters, and very soon, General James Adams went on to be reelected to that position twice more and even hold on to that 10 acres of land until the day he died. But this modus operandi of Abraham Lincoln's, where he would lampoon his opponents in the newspapers, was greatly curtailed after the close call with Colonel James Shields, when he realized how badly he could wound another person's feelings by making fun of him. And from then on, the jokes would be saved mostly for himself in self-deprecation. The one thing the Lost Township letters did accomplish, it got Mary Todd and Abraham Lincoln back together again, sort of. At a party thrown by Mrs. Simeon Francis, where both were invited but unbeknownst to each other, when they would meet up in the parlor, Mrs. Francis would say, "Be friends again." And they would become friends again. Very good friends. So much so that in a letter dated November 11th, 1842, Abraham Lincoln would close to a Shawnee town lawyer by saying, "Nothing new here, except by marrying, which is to me a matter of profound wonder." With absolutely no assurances, with absolutely no guarantees from anyone, Mary Todd had waited for 1 year, 10 months, and 3 days for Abraham Lincoln to get over his cold feet. The date, November 4th, 1842. The place, Springfield, Illinois, at the home of Mr. and Mrs. Edwards in their parlor. It was a rainy evening, and there were approximately 30 guests, and best man James Matheny barely had a little over an hour to get ready. And Mrs. Edwards, who loved to plan for weddings and parties and balls, only had a few hours to plan for this one. And while he was getting ready, blackening his boots, Abraham Lincoln's landlord's son, Speed Butler, would walk in on him and ask, "Where you going, Mr. Lincoln?" And according to eyewitness and best man, James Matheny, who thought Lincoln looked like he was gone off to the slaughter, replied to the boy, "To hell, I suppose." But the wedding went off without a hitch. It was presided over by Episcopal minister Charles Dresser. Abraham Lincoln, 6 feet 4 inches tall. Mary Todd, 5 feet 4 inches tall. "The long and the short of it," he would like to say. He would call her Molly. She would call him Mr. Lincoln. And the inscription on their wedding band would read, "Love is eternal." After the wedding, they would move into the Globe Tavern in downtown Springfield for $4 a week, where just 3 days shy of 9 months, their first son, Robert Todd Lincoln, was born August 1st, 1843. Approximately 5 months later, with $1,500 that included a lot he owned in downtown Springfield, he would purchase from the very minister who married him, Charles Dresser, a small wooden house on 8th and Jackson Street, where they would reside until they moved to Washington, D.C. Every spring and fall since 1839, and to supplement his income, Abraham Lincoln would join the 8th Circuit Court, first in February and then in September. He would travel this court on board his horse, the old and decrepit Tom, along with a group of other lawyers and his dear friend, the obese Judge David Davis. They would do so in all sorts of weather, rain, snow, sleet, and blizzards, even having to ford streams and rivers once the bridges were washed out by merely swimming across naked. In his saddlebags, Abraham Lincoln carried an extra shirt and a change of underwear, as well as worn copies of Blackstone's commentaries on the history of English law, Chitty's pleadings, and the statutes revisited. When they would get to these hamlets and villages or the communities, the whole town would show up looking to see justice dealt out on the prairie. They were, in fact, the celebrities of the day. Their courts could last from 2 days to a week, 10 weeks in all, 3 months out of the year, and the whole process repeated every September. And afterwards, Abraham Lincoln would entertain everyone with jokes and funny stories, building a strong following as well as a constituency for later when he delved into politics. Well, ladies and gentlemen, all I can say is thank you very, very much for having me into your home. That was Lincoln, Part 3. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed bringing it to you. I guess you can tell it's one of my favorite subjects. Please look for Lincoln Part 4 coming real soon and right here on this channel. Thank you so very much for listening. Thank you so very much for having me into your home. My name is Johnny Dark.